Stem from deep inside the bottomless well of our subconscious and inner worlds. But for today's guest, his favorite sort of terror is the invigorating fear rushing through your body that reminds you that you are alive. Colin McPhillamy is a British-Australian actor and astrologer. As a performer, he's worked on Broadway, Off-Broadway, and the National Theatre in London. In China, he taught Shakespeare, and his books and blog are available at McPhillamy.com. In today's episode, he shares the story of ghostly sausages, haunted butterflies, the potency of an empty theatre, and a harrowing story about a mysterious apparition on Parliament Hill in the UK. So pour yourself a nice cup of tea or something stronger. Settle in and get cozy. Because I'm your host, Sasha Graham, and this is Ghost Stories by the Fire. Colin, thank you so much for joining me.
Sasha, thank you very much for having me. Great pleasure to be here.
I'm so excited to hear, because I have heard you tell stories at my live Ghost Stories by the Fire event. I'd love it if you'd share a spooky story right now.
Oh, gosh. Yes. Well, I've been thinking about this. One of the questions I've heard you ask previous guests is, you know, what's the most frightened you've ever been? And I've been thinking about different kinds of fear. And as you know, I'm my day job is that I'm an actor, and I've been an actor for a long time, 40 years, I think. I always love to say in any kind of public forum, I'm an actor, and the chances are you've never heard of me. And the reason for that is that almost all my work has been on stage, not screen. And I've worked from Northern Scotland to Southern Australia, and from Jerusalem to Beijing, and lots of places in between, including Broadway and Off-Broadway and the National Theatre. Here and there, I get around. And in my line, they pay you in fun. Lovely. So the reason I mention it is that there's a specific kind of fear that goes with performing. The anxiety of a first night, usually the first public performance, is its own special brand of fear. And depending on the quality of the production that you're in, you know, can vary from a sort of an agreeable frisson of the nervous system hyperstimulated, not unlike the potent sensation of being in love, right? Or at the other end, it can be the kind of hyper anxiety fueled by an unholy mix of caffeine, possibly alcohol, maybe nicotine, the sort of anxiety that you would come across in one of the darker short stories by Edgar Allan Poe, for example. Or somewhere in between. So that's its own very specific brand of fear, and you know, it's a bit addictive, to be honest.
Just going to ask you, because it sounds quite addictive.
Well, what it does, Sasha, is that it brings a bit of color into your drab gray existence. You know what I mean? So when you are in hyperstimulated states like that, at least you know you're alive. Okay, so there's that. There's the sort of quotidian and rather unwelcoming anxiety that you can get when, for example, you might get an audit notice from the IRS and you go, oh, God, where are the receipts? You know, that kind of thing. In fact, I got audited, I think the first year, I'm not from around here. I mean, I know we're in virtual space, but I'm not from America. Can you tell, listeners? I was born a long way away, but I've been in America for more than a quarter of a century, and I'm just getting used to it. But the first year I was here, I was audited by the IRS. I thought it was an unfriendly move on their part. Anyway, to my mild surprise, I was able to find all the documents, and they gave me a refund of $11, which I thought was a bit of an achievement. Real, genuine verge of losing control of the bodily functions terror. I think I've only experienced that once in my life, I think. Is that right? Yeah, I think it is. I mean, of this level. And I'll tell you about it. So I was in my 20s, my late 20s. I was living in London, and in Northwest London, there's a most wonderful public space. It's called Hampstead Heath, and it's very famous. It's 700 or 800 acres of semi-wild managed woodland. It's really beautiful. And it's famous because there's a hill at the southern end of it called Parliament Hill. And the reason it's called Parliament Hill is that if you were traveling to London from the north in pre-modern days, it was the first place from which you could see the Houses of Parliament, therefore called Parliament Hill.
Right.
Anyway, it's of course mostly inhabited now by drug dealers and Russian oligarchs because they're the only people who can afford it. It's absolute. But in the old days, it used to be sort of tweedy and crumbly, and you know, it was a sort of British tea shop type of vibe. The Heath is immensely beautiful, and it's full of nature and wildlife, and there are ponds where you can go swimming and things like that. Mm. Anyway, I was living there, and not far from there. And I don't know where I'd been, but it was late at night. It was midnight or maybe half an hour later than midnight. And I was walking home, and I thought, I'll go across Parliament Hill. So from the east to the west side, I'll cut across Parliament Hill Fields. Then I'll go up the hill and down the other side, and then that'll save me 2 miles. Okay. Well, I was in a sensitive condition anyway, because I just been through a breakup, you know, one of those. Funny how it hurts so much when you're a kid, you know, I suppose you get used to it as you go older. Anyway, I was pretty devastated. Had all the symptoms, all that stuff. You know, I was writing poetry about the other person, that kind of thing. And it was a misty night. And in the slope up to Parliament Hill, there's a place, well, it's called Parliament Hill Fields because there are sort of meadows adjacent. And as I walked up the fairly gentle slope, the mist seemed to gather. And I heard some yelling in the distance, which is not unusual on Hampstead Heath. People used to go on there and, you know, have a picnic or, you know, whatever, after hours. It wasn't densely populated, but occasionally you meet, you know, kids having fun or whatever. Nothing madly serious and not hugely dangerous either. But then this is what happened. The slope began to get a bit steeper. And I suddenly looked to my right. And in the distance, which I now estimate of about maybe 300 yards, so quite a long way, away, I saw a large figure, which I estimated to be about 13 feet high. And I kind of looked, I thought, did I see that? No, I didn't see that. I'm imagining something. So I stepped on again. Then I looked again to my right, and this time it was a bit closer, maybe 200 yards. And it was still 13 feet high, as tall. It's about, you know, twice the height of a 6 foot guy. And it was shrouded in a white cowl, like a white hood, and like a monk's robe. And I couldn't see it I couldn't see its feet. I couldn't see it moving, but it was approaching me. And it was approaching me with, there's a phrase in a book by George MacDonald, which tells a similarly spooky episode. And the phrase is, with a speedy approach, but a delayed arrival. So it was rushing towards me, but not getting much closer, just a little bit closer, but huge speed. And here's the thing. It was screaming. Yes, it was screaming. And it was like the scream in Psycho, you know, in that film when Anthony Perkins stabs, you know, whatever his name is. It was, I actually saw that film in a cinema in London called the Paris Pullman, and the air was so thick with cannabis smoke, you couldn't see the no smoking signs. So you can imagine when that scream happened. Well, it was like that, but more. And suddenly, I was absolutely terrified. And I still didn't believe what I was seeing. I thought, this is completely impossible. So I took another step forward. But then here's the thing. Each step became like moving through soup. It became harder and harder to progress. And I looked over to my right again, and the figure was nearer now and still rushing. And the scream had become louder. And then I accepted that I was, in fact, seeing a ghost. And I thought, what do I do? Because I thought, if I stay here, it's going to come and get me. And, you know, it's probably got a meat cleaver or something that it's going to produce and hack me, my physical body into pieces. And that would be very sad, you know, the end to a promising career. What I hoped at that point would be a promising career. But anyway, so I thought, well, you better get out of here. So I knew that I couldn't turn round. I was so frightened. So I began to walk backwards. and as I did so, I'd heard, I can't remember from whom, but I'd heard some advice once, you know, if you encounter the supernatural or an entity or whatever, the best thing to do is to welcome them with a blessing and then say a prayer. So I did. So I would describe myself, in terms of faith, I would describe myself as a lapsed, non-observant, neo-pagan polytheist, because I was brought up in the Judeo-Christian tradition. And so I knew the Lord's Prayer, and it was handy. So I began to recite the Lord's Prayer, which I think was a sensible thing to do. And yes. I right. and then as I took each step backwards, it became a little easier to move, and the fear began to subside. So then I thought, this thought came into my head, you didn't drink anything, you didn't smoke anything, you didn't take any drugs. This is imagination. I'm going to go over the hill. So I began to walk forward again. And then so I thought, no, I can't do that. So I did back away then at some speed. And after about 10 steps, I was able to turn around and I ran. Well, I didn't run. I sprinted the way I had come through Parliament Hill fields. And until I came to the road again, and I thought, wow, I thought. So then I had to walk the long way home, another 2 miles, fine. Anyway, so then two things happened the following day. One was that I got on my bicycle and I went back to Parliament Hill Fields in the daylight. And there was absolutely no trace of that presence whatsoever, none at all, except in the meadow where I had seen the figure, about 200, maybe 300 yards distant, there was a small stone plinth commemorating, I don't know what, it was, it was that exact kind of shape, like a pyramid on a whatever. But, you know, it was sunlight, people were playing, kids, and it was great, you know. nothing scary at all. At the time, I had ventured into the netherworld called psychotherapy, right? So the next time I had a session with my therapist, I told him what had happened. And he listened patiently, and I said, well, so now you know I am crazy, right? And this is what he said. And this is what he said. He went, no, he said, because exactly the same thing happened to me.
Really? On Parliament Hill or somewhere else?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. Wait a minute, though. I'm so curious.
Yeah.
When did you see the creature's face while you heard the screaming?
No, I didn't. It was shrouded. It was kind of in shadow. And I've heard other stories about people seeing apparitions on Parliament Hill, and I'm not sure if it's the same one or if this particular apparition is a shapeshifter, you know, and able to appear in different guises. But I'm pretty convinced there's something there.
Yes.
You know.
I think I've done something like 15 episodes of this podcast thus far, and this is the third story that I have heard about a very large humanoid moving through the woods or a pastoral area.
Oh my gosh, really?
Yes, and I didn't know that these massive giant creatures, and apparently it's cross-cultural. It's found in a lot of indigenous, according to Nicholas DeFerris, who shared a story like this, it is a cross-cultural phenomena.
Good heavens. How extraordinary. Well, I had no idea. Wow. Well, yeah. So I tried to draw my therapist on what this was about, and he wouldn't say anything.
You know, oh, really? He didn't offer a psychological explanation.
He certainly didn't offer a psychological explanation, nor a supernatural one. I mean, I said something like, what do you suppose it was? You know, is this a spirit who wasn't able to complete the departure process or got stuck because of some trauma? Or, you know, and I think he nodded and we talked of other things like the weather.
Yes. I wonder, I had a guest on recently who told me that, and again, this was the first I had heard of theories of Bigfoot being an interdimensional creature, and which is kind of like a very convenient way to explain away these creatures that are like the Loch Ness Monster or Bigfoot or Yeti, who everybody will talk about, but then we can't get any concrete evidence about it. It's that story, I feel like I can see it so clearly in my mind, the way that you described it. So obviously the sense of the energy of it was terrifying, was something frightening.
Yeah, it was. And but who knows? I mean, it may have been a piece of great good fortune. Who knows? It may have prevented me running into trouble if I had gone up Parliament Hill at 1 o'clock in the morning, which isn't the most sensible thing to do in London these days, or even then.
That's an interesting hypothesis, though, that because we usually think of if something intervenes for our benefit, it's usually something kind. But sometimes perhaps being so scared that you'll stop and turn around.
I'd like to think that's a possibility. I mean, it did feel, it felt malevolent at the time. But I'm not sure. There was another ghostly encounter. This is a benign one. I was on tour it was a very significant production to me. I'm not sure if it was the best piece of theatre to hit the stage anywhere, but it was Toad of Toad Hall, and I was playing Badger, and one night I did a sort of after-hours cabaret in a theatre in Bath in the west of England. The Theatre Royal Bath is famously ghosted by a butterfly. Yeah. And during the week that we were there and I was preparing this cabaret thing, two people told me they'd seen a butterfly backstage. And that was, yeah, that was very nice. You know, it was kind of affirmation. Yeah.
Oh, that's lovely.
Isn't it gorgeous? Yeah, I love that. And actually, there's another, did I experience this? I don't think so. I was at the Old Vic in London. And the Old Vic was famously run by an extremely determined and unique individual called Lillian Bayliss, particularly between the First and Second World War and then during the Second World War. And she was amazing. I mean, actors would go to her and they would ask for a pay raise. And she would get down on her knees and then she'd stand up and say, "God says no, dear."
Don't blame me, blame the Lord.
Right. Right. And then during the Second World War, when there were air raids in London, she would come out in the middle of the show and she says, "There's an air raid in progress. If any of you would like to leave, please do so now. We are carrying on." And that would be it. You know, we're not succumbing to this intimidation. The ghost part of it was that she was famously eccentric for cooking sausages in one of the boxes at front of house. And it said that every now and then you can get the aroma of sausages sizzling quietly from box A, you know. That Lillian is looking in on the show.
Well, let me ask you, I have to say, of course, I feel like there's nothing more potent than an empty theater between shows, right?
Oh, you're absolutely right. Now that you mention it, of course that's true. Yeah.
It feels like there's pure potential, that like waiting for something to happen, that like as if ghosts are going to kind of manifest from out of nowhere and onto the stage, which of course you do for as many shows in a week as you do. Have you ever had uncanny experiences or strange feelings backstage, on stage, in and around your work? And have you ever had trouble shaking off a character that maybe just didn't want to leave you?
Oh, that's really interesting. Yes. Well, of course, that potency of the empty theatre, you're absolutely right about that. I hadn't quite thought of that. And of course, the light, the stand with the single bulb is called a ghost light. Well, after the show's over and everything's cleared, they just leave a single light standing in the middle of the stage. So there's some illumination, you know, if somebody stumbles in or locked in or whatever, there's some illumination in the darkness. So I don't know how spooky I did, you know, in most theaters, there's a crossover. So you can get from one side of the stage to the other. Sometimes it's behind, sometimes it's underneath. I was in a strange theater one time and I needed to cross over and it was quite quick. So I was going quite fast and I bumped into someone. I said, "Oh, I'm so sorry," because, you know, what happened? English people do that. They bump into someone, then they apologize. So I said, "I'm so sorry." And I didn't get an answer. And I said, "I'm sorry." Nothing happened. I said, "Well, you might say something." Of course, I realized there was no one there. And I just felt silly. I could feel myself going red in the darkness.
I know that you've done lots of Dickens shows, and I just wondered if, and to perform Dickens, especially around Christmas time, which for my money is I think that Christmas, Hanukkah, the end of the year, I think it's way more spooky and haunted than Halloween. I feel like
Halloween just blows open the doors between worlds. And by the time we get, you know, to December 24th or New Year's Eve, all of the ghosts are really there, you know, because the families are together, our expectations are high. It's just such a packed time of year. And so I'm curious if in playing and doing Dickens at that time of year, if you yourself ever felt sort of extra haunted.
The answer is yes, actually. A couple of years ago, I did a really, I've been in adaptations of Dickens novels. A couple of years ago, I did a really, an unusual and a rather marvelous solo adaptation of A Christmas Carol, but told from Jacob Marley's perspective, written by an actor called Tom Mueller. It's a really brilliant piece of work. Tom had played Scrooge in Chicago for, I think, 7 or 8 years consecutively. And, you know, being steeped in the story, then thought, wouldn't it be interesting if we saw what Jacob Marley thought about it? So he wrote this piece. Something, I can't remember how many characters, but a lot, you know, 20 characters or whatever. But early on in the act one of the piece, like scene 3 or 4, you know, we're into it 10 minutes in or whatever, there's a vision of the underworld, and it's quite grotesque, and it's peopled by grotesques, you know, people with dripping flesh or people carrying chains of, you know, money that they cannot release themselves from, all the kind of symbolic representations of the things that caught the spirit while they were alive. And that was scary, because it wasn't that I felt, well, I did, I suppose, feel a little bit immersed in the sort of, it was just me up there, you know, and it was like, it was this viscous substance of some kind of slimy, it wasn't quite air and it wasn't quite water. And I, you know, I had to visualize all these characters as I was describing them.
I love it. So one of my favorite things that I love to ask every guest, and I love this question. So I'm going to ask you, is and there's no right or wrong answers about this, only your ideas, and you're not just an actor, you move in metaphysical circles as well, and you do astrology, and I know you from our shared love of tarot, so your creativity expands much further than just the acting bit. But knowing what you know about what it feels like to be alive, where do you think we were before we were born? And where, Colin, do you think you're going when you pass?
Oh, fantastic. Our birth is but a sleep and a forgetting. The soul that rises with us, our life's star, hath had elsewhere its setting, and cometh from afar, not in utter nakedness, and not in entire forgetfulness, but trailing clouds of glory do we come from God, who is our home. That's from a poem called Intimations of Immortality Based on Recollections of Early Childhood by the poet Wordsworth. It was written in 1805. I think he was onto something, I do. The thing is, I think that, first of all, you know, as we're doing this conversation, I'm remembering something, which is that when I was young, I lost someone to cancer, a girl. She's a bit older than me, but she died. And on the way to the funeral, I wondered if somehow she was still connected with the body. And reason I wondered was that there had been suffering and pain. And I heard her voice, and she shouted, "No!" And it was this wonderful, happy, no. And I'd once been given an acting exercise of, can you produce a happy no? a celebration. No, you know, so we were all going around going, yeah, no, whatever. Anyway, I heard this no, and I was just, it was great. It was a lovely moment. And then, in fact, sometime later, I had a visitation which was very convincing. So I feel I've been immensely privileged because I think when it comes to things for which there is no empirical proof, and of course astrology is amongst them, I mean, this is, it's really a materialist's nightmare, astrology, because there is no proof and there never will be. What there is experience, and there's untold amounts of that. If it works for you, if you've seen it work, then, you know, you can get somewhere with it. But if you're one of these people who, you know, the received wisdom of scientific orthodoxy says astrology is nonsense, well, you know, you don't know what you're missing. Anyway, one of the books I read early on was Autobiography of a Yogi. Did you ever read it? Do you know it? It's by Paramhansa Yogananda, an Indian guru who came to America in the 1920s, I think 1920s, and founded an organization called the Self-Realization Fellowship, or that's the name it goes by now. Anyway, so it's a most fantastic book. I mean, it's just a spiritual autobiography. And he talks about his guru and meeting his guru, who was an astrologer, by the way, a Vedic variety. And one of the things I particularly loved about the book is that, unusually for books of esoterica, it does get down to the nitty-gritty, and it does offer an answer about this precise question of where do we go when we die? And Yogananda's deal, or if I remember correctly, and of course I may be mistaken, but I don't think so. Finally, his guru kind of explains to him, once you achieve a certain level of development, and of course in the yogic system, it would be the ability to enter Mahasamadhi at will. Mahasamadhi, you know, is enlightenment adjacent, what we would think of. What is enlightenment? Enlightenment is unconditional love. What is enlightenment? The ability to forgive. You know, all these elevated values which are so hard, you know. Try unconditional love and then someone treads on your toe. Well, not so easy, right? I mean, we're all imperfect human beings. But according to Sri Yukteswar and Yogananda, if, as and when you do get there, and then the other part of secret Eastern doctrine is that we're all going to get there in the end, after perhaps who knows how many incarnations, some of us are slower than others, right? Then we go on to the next realm, and you know, there's a whole new set of playing cards or life tasks or whatever it is. My own personal view, as I said, that early experience of loss, and I came across a wonderful aphorism in, I think it was a Buddhist scripture, the Dhammapada, which says we are surrounded by the blessed dead who are very close to us. But having said all that, it's very hard if you've been brought up in Judeo-Christian tradition, and if you've read, for example, the Divine Comedy by Dante, it's very hard to escape the conclusion that where we go may very well depend on how we've lived. I mean, yeah. Shakespeare's play Measure for Measure has something to say about that. This man sentenced to die, a young man. He says, aye, but to die and go we know not where, to lie in thrilling regions of thick-ribbed ice.
Ooh.
I mean, isn't that wonderful? That language can be scary. Only what a Shakespeare play, well done. I mean, the short answer is I don't know. Of course I don't know. How would I know, you know, while we're here as a sort of... But I think I feel confidently hopeful. Again, you know, as Plato said, either we continue or we don't, in which case it's like going to sleep. And who doesn't enjoy a good night's sleep? Rumi, that's the one to quote, really. I died a mineral and became a plant. I died a plant and became an animal. I died an animal and became a human. I died a human and became an angel. When did I ever become less by dying? Or Walt Whitman, which is also beautiful. I love this quote. He says, to die is commoner than anyone supposes and luckier. Which, of course, it is. And I think it's interesting. I mean, I feel like saying, I'm very glad you asked me that question. Not that I'm any nearer to the answer, but I'm certainly nearer to the question because I'm 66, you know. And that's a surprise to me. I never quite expected to get to this, venerable age. Should be an elder and respected by the young. That hasn't quite happened. But the other thing is that, Tolstoy, at the end of one of his short stories, Master and Man, talks about, this man dies, passes into the afterlife, and he has a certain view of it. And Tolstoy's sentence at the end of, and whether he was right or not, each of us will very soon know. Yeah, I mean, it's such a temporary situation, isn't it, being alive? We make this indescribably brief appearance here. You know, I mean, even in terms of, temporal years, 80s, whatever it is, years you get. But from the point of view of geological time, it's a blip, to say nothing of cosmological time. I mean, it's indescribably brief. And it's such a mystery to be here, with all its attendant experiences and joys and sorrows. And what is it about? An astrologer friend of mine said, and I love this too, she said, our lives are television for God.
Well, I've put on a good show. I don't know about you. I'm earning my day rate, God.
Excellent.
It's so good. I love that too. I love just listening to you talk too. I think about God forbid, right? No pun intended, but like if the end was to come tonight, it would have seemed all so quick. It would have seemed like it was all a dream. Your whole life, everything you've been through, it is a blink of an eye. It's incredible to think about. I love to think about it.
Yeah, I don't know. I think, I'm very interested in the whole deal. I've read a few books here and there. I mean, what do I know? But I've read books that I've enjoyed. Raymond Moody is the doctor, I think. Life Before Life, Life After Life. You know, this whole idea. Actually, someone whose perspective on incarnation and in fictional form that I very much enjoy is the late, great novelist Doris Lessing, and she wrote sort of psychological novels with a neo-feminist, well, not even neo, just a feminist flavor, starting in the 60s and 70s. And then she wrote a quintet of novels, which was science fiction. And really cool. And the first one is called Shikasta, and it's a kind of retelling of the Old Testament from a science fiction point of view. And I think it's a masterpiece. And then the second one in the series sort of develops on and on. But she has this whole deal about, this very challenging idea that's around that we choose the life we get. We choose our parents and we design it, in fact, And that's a hugely challenging idea. And, you think, really? I signed up for this.
It's funny, Colin. I will say it's funny that you say that because I've not had many ghostly experiences that I remember. And I don't know if I've ever shared this with you before. And I am very skeptical. I am very, because I want to know if something's happening. I really want to know that it's actually happening, that it's not my imagination or But I was, my husband and I were just starting to try and have a baby. And out of nowhere, I was painting a bedroom. Out of nowhere, I felt energies in the room with me. There were three distinct energies, and the one in the middle picked me. And I went, I'm going to be pregnant. They just picked me.
Wow.
They appeared and then they left. And I didn't see them. I sensed them, but I knew what was going on. And I said to my husband, I think it's going to happen quickly. And sure enough, it did. And to grapple with that for myself, to know that if that why would I have, why would any of, I mean, I can tell you why my daughter picked me. I mean, obviously, come on. But like, but I mean, to take that is to be, you know, follow that through logically. It's wild. It's a wild, wonderful thing to think about.
Certainly is, isn't it? Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, you know, I think the idea or the doctrine of pre-birth existence was certainly very well known to Plato. His whole deal was that, you know, each individual soul inhabits a star, and when ready to incarnate, descends through each planetary realm to arrive here at the precise moment that corresponds with the life plan. So if you are interested in following up on that idea, a very good first step would be to find an astrologer and tell them your birthday.
And where could someone find a good astrologer, Colin?
Well, interesting idea. Well, you could start at pleasantvilleastrology.com. And if you hit the About page, I think there's a sort of introductory video that gives you some idea of what we're after. Astrology is much misunderstood and much misrepresented. It's really about more than, is this a good day to go shopping? You know, ultimately, it's a wonderfully sophisticated tool for self-awareness and self-knowledge and exploration, I think. And it's one of those things, bit like acting, really, that lets you know you're alive, which is, in general, I think, a good thing.
Do you offer long-distance readings and classes as well?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, what would we all do without Zoom that we've become so used to? I mean, certainly, yeah. Worldwide, totally, of course, yeah.
Excellent. Well, I can't thank you enough for coming on my Ghost Stories by the Fire. I love to hang out with you any and all times, but I feel like it's an extra special joy for me to share you with the world so they can all see how wonderful.
Sasha, thank you so much. What fun.
Thank you so much for being part of Ghost Stories by the Fire. Do you have a spooky story, near-death experience, or supernatural happening you'd like to share? I'd love to hear it. Submit your story to sashagraham.com with Ghost Stories by the Fire in the subject line. You might just wind up on this podcast. And if you want to support it and keep the ghost stories coming, head on over to sashagraham.com to check out my books and tarot decks, which are available for purchase at your favorite bookseller. The Ghost Stories by the Fire theme song is titled Lovely, from the original motion picture score of The Deeper You Dig, a film about the lengths a mother will go to find her daughter's killer. Thanks again for listening, and until next time, I'm saving you a seat at the fire.